fighters. The ultimate predators. New discoveries in forensic science bring to life the prehistoric art of war. This is Jurassic Fight Club. It happened about 70 million years ago. At the top of the world, the first ice caps are formed, reaching down to what is now modern-day Canada. South of the Arctic Circle, incredibly, the land is inhabited by dinosaurs. Winter cloaks the terrain in total darkness. Snow and ice force dinosaurs to migrate into modern-day Canada to escape the harsh conditions. As they head southward, they're chased by two killers. One is an apex predator. The other is the disintegration of the Arctic world. Summer 1986, Pipestone Creek in northwest Alberta, Canada. A team of paleontologists on a routine dig make a startling discovery. It's the remains of an entire herd of dinosaurs, over 3,500 bones, with up to 100 bones packed in per square meter, and including 14 skulls in total. It is one of the most spectacular finds in dinosaur history. They quickly identify the dinosaurs as Pachyrhinosaurus. Heavy skull predecessors of Triceratops. A typical adult measured about 23 feet long, stood about 7 feet tall, and weighed as much as 4 tons.
This thing is built like a truck, but a truck with big spikes sticking out of the end of it. So if you are fortunate enough to be in front of a charging Pachyrhinosaurus, it would be like standing in front of a truck that's coming at you at 25 miles an hour. The first thing you notice is this big, lumpy mass on the end of its nose. We call that a boss.
Well, some paleontologists believe that house a gigantic horn, like the horn of a rhinoceros.
With almost every known dinosaur, their horns are made of bone. But in case of Pachyrhinosaurus, we think that horn could have been made of either hair or keratin like our fingernails. And that stuff decomposes when the animal dies.
A closer study of a modern rhinoceros would reveal that their horns attach differently to the skull than they did to Pachyrhinosaurus.
We actually got specimens of rhinoceros that passed away in zoos and look very closely at exactly how the horn attaches to the bone. The result of that shows that the structure that we see here in this rhino is actually not what we find in Pachyrhinosaurus. It's a very different kind of structure.
Behind the boss, protecting the neck and shoulders, Pachyrhinosaurus sported its other distinguishing feature, a bony headdress called a frill.
The frills were clearly functional because this is something that was passed on from generation to generation. It may have started off as a species recognition, sexual display mechanism, but both male and female have it. So I'm sure in the end it helped in terms of protection. If you're going to bring down a ceratops, you're not going to be able to get it by the neck because there's nothing to grab on under but solid bones this thick.
Then, by studying the bones of the site, paleontologists found another clue. This herd consisted of all ages, from the very young to full-grown adults. This cross-section gave clues of how the Arctic dinosaurs formed, physically changed as they got older.
One of the things that's really interesting when we look at these nasal bosses in these different Pachyrhinosauruses is that no two are alike. They're all different, which tells a lot potentially about the animal's age, maybe about its sex, but also about its general health. These are all the kinds of parameters that animals are using to judge whether their female judging potential father for her children, or potentially male sizing each other up for battle. Then the mystery deepened. Scientists quickly discovered that these dinosaurs had all died at the same time.
Finding remains in one place could mean only one thing. The entire herd had been wiped out suddenly and catastrophically.
Ceratopsian bone beds almost certainly all represent catastrophes. And these catastrophes only happen when the animals are moving together in herds. And in the fossil record, we see that the Ceratopsian dinosaurs, every now and then, they go raw. So maybe one in a hundred bone beds we find turns out to be one of these mass death sites where we have horned dinosaurs and traveling herds die all of us.
But why? With the Arctic vanishing, the seas began to change on planet Earth for the first time. This triggered a domino effect. deadened flesh lusts.
This is what we get if you have a lot of big animals in fast-flowing water. A single puppy dinosaur is probably easy to swim through even a relatively fast-moving stream. But when you get two, or four, or a dozen, or a hundred going into the water, they interfere with each other, their limbs trip each other up, and they get entangled and drown. The force stream carries these bodies together and washes them up against the shoreline or at the curve of the stream. We see that today when a herd of antelope try to cross the stream at one stage together. They get stacked up against each other. And that seems to have happened at Pipestone Creek back in the 1890s.
The small grains of dirt surrounding the bones supported the flood theory.
Different sized grains of dirt travel at different speeds. Fast-moving water means little grains travel very quickly, bigger grains lag behind. So when they found these dinosaurs were completely encased in the same size grain, and that tells us that these animals were washed in their position.
But the flash flood brought on new questions. A few deaths would have been understandable, but what would have caused an entire herd of ankylosaurus to charge into a flood, and certain death? Lawrence Witt of Ohio University conducted CAT scans on the brain case of Pachyrhinosaurus, looking for clues as to how the dinosaur may have behaved. He found that this animal wasn't overly intelligent. It operated on raw instinct.
What that small brain structure in Pachyrhinosaurus tells us is that the animals were probably not problem solvers. They didn't have the capacity necessarily to sort out what was going on in their environment. They're a very instinctual animal.
You really couldn't throw Pachyrhinosaurus a curve and have the animal deal with it. It was a very instinctual, hardwired animal. Being an animal that reacts instinctively, with an intellect, it's easy to understand how an entire herd of Pachyrhinosaurus could have been stampeded into a fast-flowing river. Because of the small brains, these dinosaurs had a shoot first and ask questions later, but what Pachyrhinosaurus lacked in brains, it more than made up for in brawn. Although the brain was small, it was protected inside the dinosaur's chief weapon, an armored skull. Think of it as a prehistoric Batman.
Ceratopsian brain cases are actually separated from their skull, which means that they can actually have a large impact on something, and it's not going to addle their brain, whether it's a dinosaur, or maybe even knocking down trees, to get some more edibles. That massive skull is the biggest weapon, and it's what they use to defend themselves.
In a fight, Pachyrhinosaurus is going to do one thing, and that is to face attack. And as it attacks, Pachyrinosaurus will lower his head down and charge, and just as it did target, it's going to raise its head up. What this does is it thrusts the horn in and then up, and when it's a huge wound, it attacks. Multiply that at as many as a thousand.
And you have Pachyrhinosaurus' other big weapon, strength in numbers.
Pachyrhinosaurus was a herd dinosaur, and therefore it can operate together. The main benefits are the number of eyes available. The more eyes around, the more chance you have of seeing a predator coming. Plus, if you've got a bunch of big animals with big horns or big grills working together, they can fight off even the fiercest predators that live in that area.
Included not only what is now Alberta, Canada, but also Alaska and Montana, where the remains of Pachyrhinosaurus have been found.
The fact that Pachyrinosaurus found so many different areas suggests that these dinosaurs had a remarkable ability to adapt to a variety of environments. It also tells us that these migrating dinosaurs, this Arctic dinosaur, was pushed from its home by climate change and round-the-clock darkness.
During the summer months, when there was a lot of food to be had in the Arctic, 24 hours of sunlight was a lot of good plant material. These Pachyrhinosaurus were moving north in the Arctic and dispersed. Fed all summer, but then fall came, suddenly they faced 24 hours of darkness, so they had to get out of there, so they likely to herd again, move south to Alberta, and then disperse once again down there for the winter months.
Fossilized plants found this site suggest 75 million years ago. This creek was an ideal place for a herd migrating Pachyrinosaurus to come south and feed.
One of the interesting things about the Pipestone Creek locality, where the evidence is plants, including some petrified wood, which generally lay beneath the bones. There was palm, there was porous, there were leaves,
and the general tenor of plant remains was that it was a deciduous-type forest.
But that headline source was actually a thesis of the murder. Only panic explains the vast drought. So what would have triggered the chaos? A new discovery would reveal a ferocious apex predator nearby. It was a find that would change what we thought we knew about the object of prehistoric world. The discovery of one of the largest prehistoric graveyards ever on Earth revealed a kill field. An entire Earth packing right source would drown in a flash flood. What exactly drove there? First, scientists found hacking resource bones that had long spinal fractures, indicating that they had been trapped in a panic stampede. Then, they found the answer they had been searching for. Buried among the bones, they found the teeth of a predator. It was a species of Tyrannosaur.
Suggested to us what these tyrannosaurs teeth are in fact from animals that are trampling the bodies of the final line of evidence came from the bones. We started finding two marks of tyrannosaurs on the surface of the bones. No question that one time that the tyrannosaurs were definitely eating the bodies of those packed tyrannosaurs shortly after that.
A closer inspection of the shape of the teeth and the number of serrations pointed to the member of the tyrannosaur family who was responsible for the attack. It was the most deadly predator of its time. A Herbosaurus. The lizard of Alberta. An apex predator of the Tyrannosaur species. This meaty menace lived a few million years before its larger and better known cousin, T-Rex.
So a T-Rex is the SUV or the Mantra version of Albertosaurus, the sports car, the same basic design, but sleeker, more elegant, and almost faster than adults. Albertosaurus measured 30 feet long, stood 11 feet tall at the hips, and weighed as much as 3 tons. The carnivore had five key Tyrannosaur features that made it a fierce predator.
First and foremost, Albertosaurus possessed a powerful set of jaws and an obsessive dagger-like teeth. Sharp both at the point and along the sides. They were clearly used to slice through rather than crush their prey.
Their teeth are recurved, which means they sort of point backwards, and they're also very blade-like and have serrated edges. It's pretty unique because they're perfectly adapted for slicing meat, but not necessarily for crunching bone.
The second key Tyrannosaur feature was binocular vision, giving it keen depth perception.
Tyrannosaurs, like Albertosaurus, generally had a very good sense of vision. A very important part of that relates to how the inner ear, the motion detectors of the head, relate to the sense of vision. What that shows us is that Tyrannosaurs, just like Albertosaurus, would be able to move their eyes and their heads and their necks quickly to track prey. The next key feature was a pair of short but powerful arms.
Although the arms of Albertosaurus were small compared to its overall body size, they were still packed in muscle. This meant the arms were very strong, but their function is somewhat of a mystery. They may have been used to hold prey as their mouth teeth did their dirty work, or they may have been used during reproduction.
Two long, muscular legs still chased down prey. Some biomechanical studies have estimated that Albertosaurus could have run nearly 30 miles per hour. That's nearly the speed of a modern lion.
Albertosaurus was quite fast, in fact, although they lived at different times, could have potentially even outrun T-Rex, and it had quite long to the eye, and quite long to the parts too, in terms of the length of the female. So, pretty fast animal.
At last, Albertosaurus utilized a long tapered tail for easy maneuvering.
The tail works as a counterbalance, so they can swing their tail one way or the other while running, and that helps them turn. We see that today in modern animals, like big cats are running. They swing their tail this way or that, and that helps them turn much more quickly.
With this package of Tyrannosaurus features, Albertosaurus was adapting to different environments.
Most specimens of Albertosaurus find are found only in one place in Alberta, which was the coastal plain. So we know that those dinosaurs lived in an environment very similar to what we see in Gulf States today or Northern Florida. But we have other Albertosaurus specimens from Montana that appear to be different species, and they appear to have lived in environments that were much more inland, places that at least seasonally were very dry. So it may well be that although Albertosaurus lived in a wide variety of environments, it may have broken up into different species in specific environments.
But there's another clue to how this predator lived. At a site in central Alberta, Canada, called Dry Island Bone Bed, the discovery of multiple Albertosaurus skeletons showed that this predator hunted in packs. In order to understand the hunting methods of Albertosaurus, paleontologists compared its brain design to that of modern animals.
The brain structure of Albertosaurus shows that the cerebrum, the higher centers of the brain associated with cognition and problem solving, they're not tremendously large. You can look at animals today, such as crocodilians and some of the predatory lizards today, like monitor lizards, that also don't really have particularly large cerebral hemispheres. Yet they're capable of a variety of different kinds of hunting styles. So it apparently doesn't take that much brain power to be a good predator. The brain structure of Albertosaurus would tell us it was able to do ambush predation, and probably had the brain power to be a pursuit predator. In other words, it could chase after its prey.
Albertosaurus had an S-shaped neck that allowed it to snap its prey like a striking snake.
In a fight, what it would do is it would face its attacker and rush in head first with massive teeth and grab its prey and rip a huge chunk of it. He's not interested in wrestling with you. He simply wants to inflict an injury and let you
bleed.
By studying
great sight, paleontologists were able to place Albertosaurus as a seed, because as it was eating, it shed its teeth.
When Albertosaurus feeds, oftentimes when it reaches the bone, it can break off a tooth. We call those teeth shed teeth, meaning they're shed during the feeding process. Anytime you find shed teeth at a site where there's planted bones, it's a very clear indication that a meat eater was chewing on the bones. We don't find the meat eater's bones because it died, it fed, and moved on. All that left is its teeth, its shed teeth.
Scientists also believe that Albertosaurus fed on the members of the herd soon after they died, most likely after they were washed up on shore.
When we have this massive mass of dead bodies sinking and rotting in the ancient Cretaceous sun, that's going to attract all sorts of predators, including the top meat eater of the time, Albertosaurus. Eating and munching and some of their teeth that are about to fall out because dinosaur teeth are always being a new life cycle are going to be left in with the bones and the rotting meat, the pack of dinosaurs. So when we find these shed teeth of Albertosaurus in Pipestone Creek, it shows us that the Albertosaurus were scavenging just as any decent meat eater will do. It's meat that doesn't fight back.
But this only explains the aftermath of what happened at Pipestone Creek. Like a prehistoric disaster movie. The Arctic dinosaur's world was collapsing around it, and giant predators cut off every escape. It had only one choice left, and it did shock even the most seasoned paleontologists. Arctic world came to a violent end. Paleontologists pored over the remains to learn startling new facts.
Pachyrhinosaurus and Albertosaurus are both very large, and that large size immediately confers a great amount of strength. Neither of them are particularly delicate animals, but certainly out of the two, Albertosaurus was certainly the more delicate. It had relatively long legs, and it only walked around that two of them. And so consequently, Albertosaurus was in greater danger of having catastrophic damage take place. Pachyrhinosaurus, though, was a more compact, quadrupedal kind of animal, a more sturdy build than what we see in Albertosaurus.
Albertosaurus was a forerunner of the T-Rex. It had more functioning arms, but its head was smaller and less powerful. So it had to use its relatively short arms to help catch prey, a less efficient method.
Albertosaurus has long, slender legs and a shock-absorbing foot. It would have been among the fastest bipedal animals in the history of the world, just for big animals. Pachyrhinosaurus, not so much. It would have been fast as far as a quadrupedal dinosaur goes, but that's nowhere near as much as a tyrannosaur would have been.
There are two forms of locomotion in dinosaurs. There is bipedal and quadrupedal. Quadrupeds like Pachyrhinosaurus walk on fours. This stance gives them an advantage of being more stable, especially when they have turned very quickly. But Albertosaurus being a biped means that it only walks on two legs. This gives them greater speed, but less stability in turning quickly.
It could turn about as quickly as a modern elephant.
These animals were being used certainly in two very different ways. The Pachyrhinosaurus more or less pivoting on one spot, the Albertosaurus trying to circle and find advantage, were coming fast from behind or from the side. Use that to its advantage.
Albertosaurus hunted in small groups of up to five.
A third Pachyrhinosaurus would have been more than capable of standing the ground against a single Albertosaurus. But if there were more than one, well, that would make it considerably more difficult on the Pachyrhinosaurus. We know Albertosaurus hunted at least some of the time in packs. The fossil evidence proves that.
The Arctic was not home to any apex predators. Facing a monster such as the Albertosaurus would have been terrifying to the Arctic dinosaur, especially to the children of the pack.
It's completely possible, and in my opinion, pretty likely, that one of the hunting methods of Albertosaurus would have been to try to separate a member from the herd. Once they have separated, then killing it is a lot easier, because they don't have to tend to the entire group. This is the same technique that we see in modern predators. Animal behavior doesn't change, so we look at hunting methods of, say, a lion, and it gives us a window into the hunting methods of an Albertosaurus.
Arctic dinosaurs gathered in herds, not only for protection, but also to share body parts.
We know, based on the geological events, that the herd ended up in a flooded river, but very few animals attempt to cross a river when it's flooding. Well, we don't have the evidence that tells us exactly what happened and why these animals chose to swim the river, but something drove them into it. The only explanation I can think of is that they were forced into the river. It's certainly plausible that they were being chased into it by something as big as Albertosaurus.
The Albertosaurus could not withstand the Arctic cold. It didn't have enough fat to insulate it.
The main weapon of Albertosaurus is very powerful bone-crushing, flesh-tearing jaws. And behind it, it's got a pretty good computer, a big brain as far as dinosaurs go, and really good senses, great vision, great sense of smell. Pachyrhinosaurus weapons, it's got this very powerful nose mass, whether it's a horn or a lump. That's a very good defensive weapon.
Pachyrhinosaurus could have been as long as 3 feet. Men of any intelligence think it was shaped like a rhinoceros, but much larger.
The test of fighting skills between the type of dinosaurs, like the Albertosaurus on one hand, and the horned dinosaurs, like Pachyrhinosaurus on the other, that's a test of the extremes for the meat-eaters and the plant-eaters. The Tyrannosaurs are built to kill. They're built to kill in a particular way. They come in with high speed, come in with super powerful jaws that can clamp, lock, and tear. But on the flip side, the horned dinosaurs have the power of numbers, the power to operate herds, these cranial weapons, whether they're horns or lumps. They survive against the tyrant dinosaurs pretty well.
The Pachyrhinosaurus is one of the few dinosaurs found in the Arctic. The Tamimus was found in Australia, which had once been connected to brewing cold Antarctica. This tiny biped may have been the only hybrid dinosaur.
It's possible that these animals formed into truce to protect themselves against attacks as some of the large groups of mammals do today. The predators will catch the weaker ones, the laggards, they will grab off individuals in the periphery of the group, but the group as a whole is going to survive. And this is one big advantage of the gregarious nature of a lot of animals, including the dinosaurs.
Another gold-letter dinosaur was the Elinosaura, whose huge eyes could see in the dark.
We're faced with a very difficult task when trying to understand creatures that lived 70 million years ago. Behavior doesn't fossilize like bone, and so we have to look at modern animals as a way to understand how dinosaurs may have behaved. By looking closely at the evidence we do have, and by studying modern animal behaviors, we can recreate a very realistic depiction based on fact and solid science.
Elinosaurus hunted like eagles, using their feet to hold down prey, and their sharp eyes to spot victims of three miles away. How did these nightmarish creatures push an entire pack of Arctic dinosaurs into a flash flood? And what did this mean for the ultimate extinction of this rare creature? Scientists raced to piece together evidence that lay buried for 75 million years.
Lions are perfect examples of how seek out members of the herd and target the weakest for attack. These adversaries know that a weak member of the herd is less likely to put up a vigorous defense, and so the chances of being injured are reduced. Unlike many dinosaurs, the Albertosaurus wanted to chase prey.
This is higher effective and made it easier to kill.
Alerted to the presence, the pack dinosaurs take up a defensive stand and begin to scan the forest for their unseen attack. Realizing that the herd is aware of them, the Albertosaurus leave their hiding positions and move in toward the waiting pack dinosaurs.
Even though these dinosaurs stand their ground, these Albertosaurus, the pack dinosaurs, are hardwired to flee and further scientific danger. By turning and running away, it exposes the weakest member, it ensures the health and well-being of the rest of the herd. This is nature's way of weeding out sick, old, and injured. The breaking of the cuts, the ocean's closed, is now North America, causing a dramatic increase in rain.
The herd is towards the edge of the river, but they're unable to cross, so they have to make a stand. They lower their head and thrust their nasal horns towards the predator. The Albertosaurus pays back and forth, probing for any weakness in the defense, as they take turns making mock charges at the host of the panicking group. They get their chance, and one of the herd members breaks ranks and runs.
The Pachyrhinosaurus herds were made up of a few dominant males and a harem of females and their children.
Albertosaurus live on instinct. The moment that Pachy breaks ranks and runs forward, the predators zero in on him and give the chase. The Albertosaurus knows that separated from the herd, this Pachyrhinosaurus does not stand a chance of defending himself. It's the old adage of divide and conquer.
The Pachyrhinosaurus was almost 3 inches thick, made a solid bone.
As it turns, the jaws of the Albertosaurus snap closed on the side's frill and broke into flying in the air. The Pachyrhinosaurus could grow back its heart if it broke. One weakness about the Brontosaurus is that it's relatively light built. Now, looking at the size, it makes it hard to believe, but when we look at the skeletal design, you'll see that the bones are hollow. These hollow bones are rigid and strong, but very, very light. So if the patch gets its luck and hits its bone, it could break without really any problem. And this would not only take the Brontosaurus out of fight, it could very well end its life.
The Pachyrhinosaurus had a low center of gravity. This allowed it to move quickly to keep its horn and protective frill facing an attacker.
Pachyrhinosaurus, like pretty much all members of the Ceratopsian family, have no weaponry from behind their neck backwards. From their neck back, they're completely vulnerable and they have no weapons. They have no spikes. They have nothing. All the weapons are in the front, so to attack an animal like Pachyrhinosaurus, your best bet would be to attack its unprotected side or flank, or even the back of the neck behind the cheek. The skin of the Pachyrhinosaurus was up to three inches thick, and considered the toughest of an elephant or rhino. Once the Pachyrhinosaurus is knocked to the ground, he's basically helpless. All the Brontosaurus will need to do is grab him by the throat or rip open his belly. Those sharp straight teeth can cut flesh like a high-end butter. When you calculate the dimensions of the jaws of the big meat eater, you can see that they can bite off and swallow 100 pounds of flesh in every single bite.
The Arctic was changing forever. It would go from a wasteland to a lush paradise for animals of all kinds. But it would not be kind to the Arctic dinosaurs. It was headed for extinction, and its demise would be vicious and painful. 7 million years ago, in what is now Canada, two Albertosaurus charged up Earth with Pachyrhinosaurus, causing a stampede towards a flooded river. The Albertosaurus has a fast metabolism, like the birds of today. This forced it to feed frequently to replenish its energy.
Because of the lower center of gravity, dinosaurs like Pachyrhinosaurus would have been able to recover quickly from a fall. They have very powerful front rear legs, and this makes getting back up if you fall a lot easier. As quickly as it knocked them down, it's back up on its feet again.
The Pachyrhinosaurus had legs as thick as a grown man's waist. They were also relatively dense, like the legs of an elephant, not as hollow as those of the Albertosaurus.
The thin legs of the Brontosaurus are too weak because it wouldn't take much force to crack or even break the leg. But because they're relatively thin, they're a smaller target. The Pachyrinosaurus misses the bone and only rips the skin, and this enrages the Albertosaurus, who then goes for broke.
The Cretaceous period was not as hot as the Jurassic. The temperatures were still hotter than today, but the relatively cooler climate allowed the dinosaurs to be more active. This was an advantage for the meat eaters, who expended more energy in the fight than the planets. The Albertosaurus also had a cavernous stomach. It could have eaten a cow in a single meal. Its endless appetite drove to savage butchery.
The Brontosaurus paces back and forth, pushing the herd into a tight formation. From experience, it knows that if packed into tight, then they lose their ability to move independently, and that's when they'll strike.
The brig of the Pachyrinosaurus can only think one thing: time. They react, they do not plan. If they're focused on an attacker, they're not attuned to their environment. One by one, the Pachyrinosaurus are being pushed into the river as the herd moves back.
Normally, these dinosaurs would be able to swim without any trouble, but now they're in panic mode, and it's every dinosaur for himself. In their struggle to get away from the Albertosaurus, they begin to drown each other. The Pachyrinosaurus would swim like a dog, holding its head above water and paddle with its feet.
This was impossible when they were too tightly packed together. The Albertosaurus was not a good swimmer. Its small arms were useless in the water, leaving it to rely on its two powerful legs.
Even though the Albertosaurus is capable of swimming, there is no way it's going to get into a flooded river. But The sight of herd floating downstream is too much for him to ignore, so he heads off to follow the river and look for an opportunity to snatch one from the water.
The protective thrill of Pachyrhinoceros was capable of showing color. It mainly reflected the emotions of Pachy, like a billboard.
When the Pachyrhinoceros bodies came to the bend in the river, the momentum of the water pushed their carcasses to the outer edge of the bend. Their bodies became intertwined with each other and started a mass pileup. Once the floodwaters receded, the exposed bodies began to rock.
At the end of the Arctic Age, floods were becoming more common. The smell of the drowned carcasses was drawn predators from miles around. Some predators at that time could smell prey up to 5 miles away.
Examples of modern animals that, when trying to cross a river, things can turn into sheer carnage. It happens with wildebeest, it happens with caribou, it happens time and time again. And each time it occurs, predators either cause it or show up very quickly to take advantage of it. The evidence at Pipestone Creek proves that these animals were killed in mass and then covered in mud in a bed in the river. And Albertosaurus were there to feast on the remains.
Albertosaurus and Pachyrhinoceros eventually succumbed to extinction. The climate change was late in the Cretaceous period, with the beginning of the end.
The reason why? It's probably environmental changes. It's a very tough mystery that we don't have the answers to. We know at the end of the Cretaceous period when these two dinosaurs go extinct, something big occurs in the environment. Even as far north as Canada, environmental changes are having a pretty dramatic impact. I think these dinosaurs went extinct because they simply could not deal with the global environmental changes that were occurring at the end of the Cretaceous period.
Temperatures would continue to rise, causing dinosaurs to expend too much energy to maintain a tremendous bulk.
The real big question that we want to know about Pachyrhinoceros is what's going on with that nose. Is there really a giant horn there, or was it just a lumpy mass? And if it's a lumpy mass, how is that mass structured? Are there ridges on it, lumps, crests? Always one of those specimens, and we'll know what the face of Pachyrhinoceros really looked like.
Outnumbered predators by about 4 to 1, so the only sources that found any less commonly in Pachy. Less than 40 individual Albertosaurus have ever been found, while hundreds of Pachys have been covered. Next week on Jurassic Fight Club. On a ranch in northeastern South Dakota, a routine dig unearthed signs of two of the most terrifying dinosaurs ever to walk the earth. Fossil hunters find a